Harper Audio presents Nemesis by Agatha Christie, performed by Joan Hickson.
In the afternoons, it was the custom of Miss Jane Marple to unfold her second newspaper. Two newspapers were delivered at her house every morning. The first one Miss Marple read while sipping her early morning tea, that is, if it was delivered in time. The boy who delivered the papers was notably erratic in his management of time. Frequently, too, there were either a new boy or a boy who was acting temporarily as a stand-in for the first one. And each one would have ideas of his own as to the geographical route that he should take in delivering. Perhaps it varied monotony for him. But those customers who were used to reading their paper early so that they could snap up the more saucy items in the day's news before departing for their bus, train, or other means of progress to the day's work, were annoyed if the papers were late. Though the middle-aged and elderly ladies who resided peacefully in St. Mary Mead often preferred to read a newspaper propped up on their breakfast table. Today, Miss Marple had absorbed the front page and a few other items in the daily paper that she had nicknamed the Daily All Sorts, this being a slightly satirical allusion to the fact that her paper, the Daily Newsgiver, owing to a change of proprietor to her own, and to other of her friends' great annoyance, now provided articles on men's tailoring, women's dress, female heartthrobs, competitions for children, and complaining letters from women, and had managed pretty well to shove any real news off any part of it but the front page, or to some obscure corner, where it was impossible to find it. Miss Marple, being old-fashioned, preferred her newspapers to be newspapers, and give you news. In the afternoon, having finished her luncheon, treated herself to 20 minutes' nap in a specially purchased upright armchair, which catered for the demands of her rheumatic back, she had opened the Times, which lent itself still to a more leisurely perusal. Not that the Times was what it used to be. The maddening thing about the Times was that you couldn't find anything any more. Instead of going through from the front page and knowing where everything else was so that you could pass easily to any special articles on subjects in which you were interested, there were now extraordinary interruptions to this time-honoured programme. Two pages were suddenly devoted to travel in Capri with illustrations. Sport appeared with far more prominence than it had ever had in the old days. Court news and obituaries were a little more faithful to routine. The births, marriages, and deaths, which had at one time occupied Miss Marple's attention first of all, owing to their prominent position, had migrated to a different part of the Times. Though of late, Miss Marple noted, they had come almost permanently to rest on the back page. Miss Marple gave her attention first to the main news on the front page. She didn't linger long on that because it was equivalent to what she had already read this morning, though probably couched in a slightly more dignified manner. She cast her eye down the table of contents. Articles, comments, science, sport. Then she pursued her usual plan, turned the paper over and had a quick run down the births, marriages and deaths, after which she proposed to turn to the page given to correspondence, where she nearly always found something to enjoy. From that she passed on to the court circular, on which page today's news from the sale rooms could also be found. A short article on science was often placed there, but she didn't propose to read that. Seldom made sense for her. Having turned the paper over as usual to the births, marriages and deaths, Miss Marple thought to herself, as so often before, "Oh, it's sad, really, but nowadays one is only interested in the deaths. People had babies, but the people who had babies were not likely to be even known by name to Miss Marple. If there had been a column dealing with babies labelled as grandchildren, there might have been some chance of a pleasurable recognition. She might have thought to herself, really, Mary Prendergast has had a third granddaughter, though even that perhaps might have been a bit remote. She skimmed down marriages, also with not a very close survey, because most of her old friends' daughters or sons had married some years ago already. She came to the deaths column and gave that her more serious attention. Gave it enough, in fact, so as to be sure she wouldn't miss a name. Alloway, Angopastro, Arden, Barton, Bedshaw, Burgo, Weiser, Dear me, what a German name. But he seemed to be late of Leeds. Carpenter, Camperdown, Clegg. Clegg? Now, was that one of the Cleggs she knew? No, it didn't seem to be. Janet Clegg, somewhere in Yorkshire. MacDonald, Mackenzie, Nicholson. Nicholson? No, again, not a Nicholson she knew. Og, Ormrod, yes, that must be one of the aunts, she thought. Yes, probably so. Linda Ormrod. No, she hadn't known her. Quantrill? Dear me, that must be Elizabeth Quantrill. 85. Well, really, she thought Elizabeth Quantrill had died some years ago. Fancy her having lived so long. So delicate she'd always been, too. Nobody'd expected her to make old bones. Race Radley, Rafiel. Rafiel? Something stirred. That name was familiar. Rafiel. Belford Park, Maidstone. Belford Park, Maidstone. No, she couldn't recall that address. No flowers, Jason Rafiel. Oh, well, an unusual name. She supposed she just heard it somewhere. Ross Perkins. Now, that might be... No, it wasn't. Ryland, Emily Ryland. No, no, she'd never known an Emily Ryland. Deeply loved by her husband and children. Well, very nice or very sad, whichever way you like to look at it. Miss Marple laid down her paper, glancing idly through the crossword while she puzzled to remember why the name Rafiel was familiar to her. It'll come to me, said Miss Marple, knowing from long experience the way old people's memories worked. It'll come to me, I have no doubt. She glanced out of the window towards the garden, withdrew her gaze and tried to put the garden out of her mind. Her garden had been the source of great pleasure and also a great deal of hard work to Miss Marple for many, many years. And now, owing to the fussiness of doctors, working in the garden was forbidden to her. She once tried to fight this ban, but had come to the conclusion that she had, after all, better do as she was told. She had arranged her chair at such an angle so as not to be easy to look out in the garden unless she definitely and clearly wished to see something in particular. She sighed, picked up her knitting bag, and took out a small child's woolly jacket in process of coming to a conclusion. The back was done, and the front. Now she would have to get on with the sleeves. Sleeves are always boring. Two sleeves, both alike. Yes, very boring. Pretty coloured pink wool, however. Pink wool. Now, wait a minute, where did that fit in? Yes, yes, it fitted in with that name she just read in the paper. Pink wool, a blue sea, a Caribbean sea, a sandy beach. Sunshine, herself knitting, and, why, of course, Mr. Rafiel. That trip she'd made to the Caribbean, the island of Saint Honoré, a treat from her nephew Raymond. And she remembered Joan, her niece-in-law, Raymond's wife, saying, "Oh, don't get mixed up in any more murders, Aunt Jane. It isn't good for you." Well, she hadn't wished to get mixed up in any murder, but it just happened. That was all. Simply because of an elderly major with a glass eye who had insisted on telling her some very long and boring stories. Poor major. Now, what was his name? She'd forgotten that now. Mr. Rafiel and his secretary, Mrs. Walters, yes, Esther Walters, and his masseur attendant, Jackson. It all came back. Well, well, poor Mr. Rafiel. So Mr. Rafiel was dead. He'd known he was going to die before very long, and he had practically told her so. It seemed as though he had lasted longer than the doctors had thought. He was a strong man, an obstinate man, a very rich man. Miss Marple remained in thought, her knitting needles working regularly, but her mind was not really on her knitting. Her mind was on the late Mr. Rafiel, and remembering what she could remember about him. Not an easy man to forget, really. She could conjure his appearance up, mentally, quite well. He has a very definite personality. A difficult man, an irritable man. Shockingly rude sometimes. Nobody ever resents his being rude there. She remembered that also. They didn't resent his being rude because he was so rich. Yes, he had been very rich. Had his secretary with him and a valet attendant, a qualified masseur. He had not been able to get about very well without help. Rather a doubtful character that nurse attendant had been, Miss Marple thought. Mr. Rafiel had been very rude to him sometimes. He had never seemed to mind. And that again, of course, was because Mr. Rafiel was so rich. Nobody else would pay him half what I do, Mr. Rafiel had said, and he knows it. He's good at his job, though. Miss Marple wondered whether Johnson had stayed on with Mr. Rafiel. Stayed on for what must have been another year, a year, and 3 or 4 months. She thought probably not. Mr. Rafiel was one who liked a change. He got tired of people, tired of their ways, tired of their faces, tired of their voices. Miss Marple understood that. She had felt the same sometimes. That companion of hers, that nice, attentive, maddening woman with her cooing voice. Ah, said Miss Marple, what a change for the better since... Oh, dear, she's forgotten her name now. Miss Bishop. No, not Miss Bishop. Oh, dear, how difficult it was. Her mind went back to Mr. Rafiel and to... No, it wasn't Johnson. It had been Jackson, Arthur Jackson. Oh, dear, said Miss Marple again. I always get all the names wrong. And, of course, it was Miss Knight I was thinking of, not Miss Bishop. Why do I think of her as Miss Bishop? The answer came to her. Chess, of course. A chess piece. A knight. A bishop. I shall be calling her Miss Castle next time I think of her, I suppose, or Miss Rook. Though really she's not the sort of person who would ever rook anybody. No, indeed. And now, what was the name of that nice secretary that Mr. Rafiel had? Oh, yes, Esther Walters. That was right. I wonder what has happened to Esther Walters. She'd inherited money. She would probably inherit money now. Mr. Rafiel, she remembered, had told her something about that, or she had... Dear, what a muddle things were when you tried to remember with any kind of exactitude. Esther Walters. It had hit her badly, that business in the Caribbean, but she would have got over it. She'd been a widow, hadn't she? Miss Marple hoped that Esther Walters had married again some nice, kindly, reliable man. It seemed faintly unlikely that Esther Walters, she thought, had had rather a genius for liking the wrong kind of men to marry. Miss Marple went back to thinking about Mr. Rafiel. No flowers, it had said. Not that she herself would have dreamt of sending flowers to Mr. Rafiel. He could buy up all the nurseries in England if he wanted to. And anyway, they hadn't been on those terms. They hadn't been friends or on terms of affection. They had been, what was the word she wanted? Allies. Yes, they'd been allies for a very short time. A very exciting time. And he had been an ally worth having. She had known so. She'd known it as she'd gone running through a dark tropical night in the Caribbean and had come to him. Yes, she remembered. She'd been wearing that pink wool. Oh, what used they to call them when she was young? A fascinator. That nice pink wool kind of shawl scarf that she'd put round her head. And he had looked at her and laughed. And later, when she had said, she smiled at the remembrance, one word she'd used and he had laughed, but he hadn't laughed in the end. No, he'd done what she had asked him, and therefore... Ah, Miss Marple sighed. It had been, she had to admit it, all very exciting. And she'd never told her nephew or dear John about it, because after all it was what they told her not to do, wasn't it? Miss Marple nodded her head, then she murmured softly, Poor Mr. Rafiel. I hope he didn't suffer. Probably not. Probably he'd been kept by expensive doctors under sedatives, easing the end. He'd suffered a great deal in those weeks in the Caribbean. He had nearly always been in pain. A brave man. She was sorry he was dead because she thought that though he'd been elderly and an invalid and ill, the world had lost something through his going. She had no idea what he could have been like in business. Ruthless, she thought, and rude and overmastering and aggressive. A great attacker. But a good friend, she thought. And somewhere in him a deep kind of kindness that he was very careful never to show on the surface. A man she admired and respected. Well, she was sorry he was gone. And she hoped he hadn't minded too much, and that his passing had been easy. And now he would be cremated, no doubt, and put in some large, handsome marble vault. She didn't even know if he'd been married. He'd never mentioned his wife, never mentioned children. A lonely man? Or had his life been so...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.